welcome to the house of the Lord. We're so excited that you're with us this morning. Are you excited to be here? Are you blessed to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Amen. Come on and stand with us. Let's worship Him for the wonderful grace that He gives us each and every day. This morning. You may be seated for just a moment as our ushers come forward to receive your tithes and offering today. And Sister Beth, if you want to come forward, she has a presentation. She wants to share with you some of the exciting things that the youth experienced while they were at Church of God Youth Camp. So we're going to pray over the offering, let the offering be taken up, and Sister Beth's going to come and speak, and then we're still going to do our meet and greet, so don't think you got out of that. I'm just sliding it into a different spot this morning. Brother Colby, will you pray over the offering in the service?
this time and say thank you for those that donated and sponsored a child to go to camp. If you can see this picture right here, I was told the girls won an award in their camp. Later found out that it was for the messiest camp. But to see the excitement that they had there, it was made possible because you stepped up behind them and supported them, and I thank you for that. I do have some others that say now they wish they would have went, and I said we have next year. So it will be coming up again next year, and some of the youth will be going. But if I can get that one slide. This is the young teens' results from their week, not the week before. We have another week starting tomorrow, and then the mini camp, I think we have three more going that week. But we had six go for the young teen. 51 young people were saved, 200 rededicated, 127 sanctified, 121 filled with the Holy Ghost, 131 healed. 57 of those kids said they was called to ministry. And this is out of a 503 campers and 178 workers. I thank my kids and I thank you.
Fun too. But I have a joke for you guys. I heard this week. I have to tell it. It was so funny. There was this man and his wife and his mother-in-law went to the Holy Land. You probably heard it. So while they were at the Holy Land, his mother-in-law passed away. So they told him that it would cost $500 to bury her there, or they could send her back to the States for $5,000. So, I mean, that seems, you know, a no-brainer, right? So the man thought about it a little while, and he said, no, I want to send her back home. I was like, are you sure? $5,000? He's like, yes, I'm sure. He said, you know, I heard a story one time about a man who died here, and in 3 days he rose from the grave, and I don't need to take that chance. Amen. For all of those visiting today, we welcome you to East Varna Church of God. We're so glad you chose to worship with us today. If this is your first time, we welcome you. For all you regulars, we're so glad you came back and decided to come back and worship with us today. I have a few announcements. Don't forget, Thursdays is the Get Out of Your Head Bible Study. It starts at 6 o'clock. We have some really good discussions. Come on out. Invite someone to come with you also. Also, we still have numerous opportunities to get involved and grow in the church, in your spiritual walk. We have Sunday school at 10 for all ages, Sunday worship at 10:45 and 5 o'clock. 5 o'clock on Sunday night. Midweek connection Wednesdays at 6:30. There's classes for everyone on Wednesday night from babies up. The Bible study at 6 p.m. We still are needing some volunteers in the nursery and with the kids ministry. You can see Sister Patsy or Sister Haley for that. July the 10th will be our midweek meal, and that'll be done by the food pantry. The meal is from 5 to 6, and all the donations will go to the food pantry. Vacation Bible School is coming up. It'll be July the 14th through the 17th. You can contact Haley Roberts for more information. It'll be 6 to 8 p.m. every night. There's a sign up in the foyer if you would like to help volunteer. There's lots of opportunities there also that you can volunteer and be a part of a child's life. And our clothing giveaway will be Saturday the 27th, I think is the date, from 8 until all the items are gone. We've had a good turnout as far as clothing. We need more children's clothes. If you know anyone that has that, please please tell them to bring them. We can work out arrangements to pick them up, or the office is open Monday through Thursday, and we can work it out that they can bring them here. This morning, I wanted to talk to you a little bit about praise. I mean, after all, that's why we come to church, right? To praise God, right? I mean, we all are alive. We're breathing. We woke up this morning. And I was reading yesterday in Isaiah where King Hezekiah, he was healed. He had pleaded to God to heal him, and God did, and he gave him 15 more years on his life. But he wrote this writing after his illness and recovery. He said, and this is taken from the latter part of 18 on to 20, death cannot praise you. You know, when you're dead, you're not going to be able to praise God. Those who go down to the pit cannot hope for your faithfulness. If you go to hell, there's no hope. It is the living who give thanks to you, as I do today. A father tells his sons about your faithfulness. The Lord is certain to save me, so we will play my songs on stringed instruments all the days of our life at the house of the Lord. Make it your goal today to praise the Lord. After all, that's the only reason we're here, to lift him up. Nothing else matters. Set your focus and eyes on Jesus, and I guarantee that he'll change your life today.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Give him a hand clap of praise this morning. He's worthy of that. Now here's your opportunity for your meet and greet. Let's get out, make each other feel welcome, and let's sing this chorus just a few more times. Wonderful grace of Jesus. Go ahead, meet and greet.
Wonderful, the massive grace of Jesus, deeper than the mighty rolling sea, higher than the mountains. Oh, man.
Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, for your abundant grace and mercy. Thank you that you saw us and you see us in the midst of our brokenness. You see us in the midst of our sin-ridden state. And God, you said, I love you enough that I will send my son to die on a cross for you, to pay the price that you could know me in the full pardon of your sins, that you could know a day where you will join me in glory, where we will bow at the throne of Christ. And I'm thankful that by the work of the cross, the veil was torn so that we can know him deeper, so that we can know him more truly, so that we don't have to have a priest to take our sins unto him, to take our needs unto him, but that we can come and enter with our praise, enter with a humble heart and a humble spirit into the holies of holies. So, Father, this morning, I just ask that you would see us as I know you do. Lord, that you would hear us as we call upon your name, as I know that you do. Father, that you would see every tear, that you would hold every tear, that you would hold every broken heart, as I know that you do. And Father, that you would do the mending work that only you can. Lord, that you would restore the joy of your salvation and uphold us by your mighty hand. Lord, we are here for you and for you alone. God, may you be free to do what only you can do as you search us and show us the things that we need to lay before you, creating us a clean heart. And Father, do what only you can do. In the mighty name of God, let all those who believe with me say, amen.
To the veil is torn and the doors fling wide. I see glory as I run inside your throne room. Before you I bow. And the veil is torn and the doors fling wide. I see glory as I run inside your throne room.
Before
you. The veil is torn, the doors fling wide. I see your glory as I run inside your throne room.
Can we just stay here for just a moment and just thank him for his holiness? Just thank him that he saw fit to see you and say that you are enough for me to send my son to die on a cross for. And not only that, but each and every morning he sees you again and says, here's a little more grace. Here's a little more mercy. It is only by that grace and mercy, only by his sustaining power in hand, that we have a hope to make it. But time and 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 time again, he pours it out upon us. So yes, Lord, you are holy. You are worthy of a moment of pause and recognition of just how great you are. Father, check us in our spirits when we would just brush by the mention of your name as if it's just another common name. Because it's not. Check us in our spirits, Lord, when we would just come into a worship service and just sing a song without one bit of intentional thought to the words that we are saying. Because you are worthy of sacrifice. You are worthy of intentionality on our part. You are worthy of our attention. You are worthy of our focus. You are worthy of our time, for without you, the very concept would not even exist. You are worthy of our submission because you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And whether we want to give it to you or not, one day every knee will bow and every tongue shall confess that you are the Lord. So, Father, in the freedom of the choice that you give me, I choose to praise you. I choose to focus on you. I choose to say that you are more than enough, even when it seems like there isn't enough. I choose to say that you are worthy of my dedication. You are worthy of my praise. You are worthy of my adoration. You are worthy of every breath in these lungs and more. You are worthy of every fiber of my being because you created every fiber of my being. Lord, when I said I would rather die, you said no. You said there is a plan, there is a purpose. When I said I would rather live in my sin, you said no. Come unto me one more time. As many times as it takes, and I will pour it out again. I will pour it out again. Because I love you. Because I see you. Because I know you. And I have great works for you. And that promise, that word is not just to me, but it is to every single one of us. Whether you believe it or not, it is true because his word declares it. Father, I thank you that you are a God that will do it again. You are a God who will meet us every single time. The lowest of depths or the highest of highs, you are always there. And I thank you, God, that you take broken things and you make them beautiful. And I thank you that you can do it again. Every single miracle that has ever happened, you are more than capable of doing it again. So, Father, I just want to speak life over your people this morning. I know that each and every one of us have come into this place with different battles, with different struggles, with different things that are weighing us down. But just as I know that there is a God in heaven who is here with us now. I know that His Spirit dwells in the hearts and the lives of His people, and that you are more than capable of meeting every single need in your perfect will, abundantly from your riches and glory. Father, let us create space in our minds to believe it, to accept it, and to see it when you do it. Because I know that you will. Lord, let your Spirit go forth. Meet your people right where they are. And do it again, Almighty God. Amen.
Faithfulness. Come on, magnify the Lord, because He's never once failed you and I in this place. Glory to God. Hallelujah. While you're standing with me this morning, I got a very powerful word for somebody this morning. Just God put it on me Wednesday, and I'm just aching to get it off of me. Glory to God. While you're standing, go with me, please, to the book of Acts, chapter 2. Acts, chapter 2, verse 34 and 36. And I want you to pay close attention to the very end of verse 36. Acts, chapter 2, verse 34 and 36. This is Peter preaching his message. He says, "For David did not ascend into the heavens, but he says himself, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ.'" Let me read that scripture one more time. "Therefore, let all the house of Israel know," and let me add, "let all of East Sparta know assuredly that God has made this Jesus," somebody shout Jesus, "whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ." I want to minister this morning on the subject, Jesus is Lord, or is He? Jesus is Lord, or is He? And that's the only question, only you can answer that question in your life. Is He Lord of your life or not? He's either Lord at all, or He's not Lord at all. He's Lord of all, or not at all. What's it going to be? Father God, as we come before Your presence this morning, we give You praise, we give You glory, we give You thanksgiving and honor. Lord, You are Lord. You are supreme. You are over everything. Hallelujah. Father, I pray today, help us, Lord, to preach on Your Lordship. Lord, a subject that is seemingly overlooked, Lord, in today's church. Help us, Father, to really understand what it means for You to be Lord of our life. Father, I pray You minister in this sanctuary, minister amongst Your people. Lord, open the hearts and the minds of every individual in this place. And Lord, let them answer that question. You're either Lord of all, or You're not Lord at all. Lord, help us today, and may help us crown You King and Lord of all in our life. And Lord, we give you praise and glory and honor for it all in Jesus' name. And everybody say amen. You may be seated. Jesus is Lord, or is he? The Lordship of Jesus Christ is one of Scripture's most significant doctrines. Glory to God. It is not ministered about hardly anymore because it's a subject that people want to stay away from. Glory to God. Why? Because the word Lord means supreme in authority. It means that he is master. It means that he is ruler. It means that he is owner. Glory to God. To proclaim, amen, out of our mouth that Jesus is Lord asserts that man, nature, kingdoms, and constellations have to yield to his mastery. You see, when we confess Jesus is Lord, it comes with the understanding, Lord God, that he not only exercised power 2,000 years ago, he exercised, amen, he existed before all things, he governs all things today, and he will continue to master all things throughout eternity. Glory to God. He is Lord. Now, I'm not trying to be some preacher. Glory to God, a name preacher that's on TV. Glory to God, I won't call his name. But I want to tell you, I think today that you and I need to make a declaration. Glory to God, so many times that is made on his broadcast that Jesus is Lord. Can you make that declaration with me today? Jesus is Lord. Glory to God. Do we? And we've got to understand and we've got to know, glory to God, because when we declare Jesus is Lord, amen, I want to tell you, it insists he's not subject to committee, amen, he's not subject to Congress, he's not subject to any government that this world, amen, is upon this world. He is sovereign and he is omnipotent. He is all powerful. When Jesus is Lord, there is no one above him, glory to God. The Lordship of Christ is not a cliche or a trivial application, amen, the Bible assigns to Jesus. That's because the New Testament word, this phrase, Jesus or Lord Jesus Christ, is used 72 times, amen, of our Lord Jesus Christ. Think about that for a moment. Lord Jesus Christ. When you study the Bible, Lord God, you find that Jesus completely satisfies everything about that designation of who he is. He is Lord, and as Lord, he was the supreme and is the supreme ruler that has conquered everything, amen, Lord God, that confronted him, death, disease, and nature. And as Jesus, which his name means Jehovah, his salvation, he surrendered himself for our sins on the cross and was resurrected in power. And as Christ, he fulfilled every Old Testament prophecy that predicted the Messiah's coming. Can I tell you, only Jesus is the only one who has ever, amen, accomplished, amen, and fulfilled over 8,000 prophecies. Do you know the number, how staggering it is for one man to fulfill over 8,000 prophecies, amen, in a book? Lord God, the numbers are just mind-boggling. I don't even have the words to tell you. It's one in whatever number you can far fathom. Lord God, more than a trillion, more than a billion, more than whatever the farthest number. Lord God, it's one in that. Amen. But Jesus Christ has fulfilled every single prophecy. And I want to tell you, because of that, Jesus is Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I don't care what this world says. I don't care what this world does. They tried to make him out as a martyr. They tried to make him out as just a prophet. They tried to make him out as just a good man. But you hear me? Jesus is Lord. Oh, I wish I had some help in here today. Listen, the Bible makes it clear. Jesus is Lord over every realm and over every kingdom. He is Lord over heaven and earth, the seas and the dry land. He governs the seasons, the stars, and the farthest galaxy. But what God is really after, amen, is the governing of our lives. All these other things, thank God, are under him. But the greatest thing that can come under the lordship of the Lord, of the Jesus Christ, is you and I. And how many of you know that that's one of the hardest things for the Lord to wrangle, is getting you and I under his lordship? We're his creation, but we still want to do what we want to do. We still want to do how we want to do. Act how we want to act. You see, it's no problem for him to manage the Milky Way. He wants us to surrender the reins of our hearts to his lordship. You see, that's why the title of this message is what it is. Jesus is Lord, or is he? You see, does Christ rule your heart today? Do you consult him about your decisions? Do you seek to serve and please him in every area of your life? Or is there some places that you just slam the door in his face and say, you cannot enter there. It is closed off to no one but me. Listen, Lord God, God cannot be Lord of just part to you. You see, I know enthroning Christ as Lord of your life and asking him, amen, to influence your decision is difficult because we don't like being out of control. We want to be the CEO and call the shots in our own life, but the truth is we aren't capable of managing our own life without God. That's why we get in trouble. That's why when we go through things, Lord God, and he's not there, whoo, that's why we feel like the world's falling to pieces. Lord God, I want to tell you folks, is he Lord or not? Jesus is Lord. That's a statement. But the question is he your Lord? Lord God, there's 3 points I want to make today. First of all, the first point is people fear Christ's lordship. People fear Christ's lordship. You see, we aren't intelligent. I don't mean to insult anybody's intelligence, but listen, we aren't intelligent enough to manage our life without God. And we travel the road of self-deceit, amen, if we assume we are clever enough to chart the course of life without his help. Been there, done that, got several t-shirts, didn't like it while I was there, so I come back to him. Come on now, I'd rather do life with him than life without him. Oh, have I got some help in here today? My Lord, you see, and it's why the Bible from Genesis to Revelation speaks of God's lordship over 1,000 times, glory to God, from cover to cover. 1,000 times God indicates, amen, he wants the opportunity to guide and protect our life. My Lord, he wants to do that. But here's Satan's lie to humanity today. He wants you to believe that surrendering control of your life to Christ means being saddled with nothing but sorrow and a whole bunch of rules. The devil wants you to believe that life will never be fun, and you'll twist in misery under the thumb of God's oppression. When the Bible speaks of Christ's lordship, that it is nothing like that. Lord God, listen, if making us miserable was God's desire, can I tell you, Lord God, he could do that without asking our permission. Lord God, you see, it would be no problem for the all-powerful sovereign God of the universe to thoroughly frustrate us every single day of our life. You see, that would be a very simple matter, glory to God. But there's one fact the Bible makes abundantly clear. Jesus is for you, not against you. I wish somebody put the devil under their feet this morning and, my God, stand up and say, God is on my side, and if God be for me, who can be against me? Praise God. I refuse to listen to the devil anymore to say, Lord God, that God's going to make me miserable and God's going to give me a lot of laws that I cannot follow. Listen, Jesus is on your side. God wants to bless your life. God wants to make and give you the abundant life that you and I don't have right now. Amen. And the devil, I wish somebody stand up and say, the devil is a liar. Praise God. Glory to God. How do you know that, preacher? Because the Word of God says he's full of love. He's full of love. He's full of goodness. He's full of mercy. He's full of compassion. And there's no way God would abandon his benevolence and deal with us in any other way. Some people think if they surrender everything to God, he'll say, okay, you crown me, Lord, I have you now. Oh, whoo. Oh, and they think if he comes to the place that I've got you now, oh, you got to, that he'll look at them, tell them, you got to quit spending time, glory to God, with your music. You got to sell your boat. Glory to God, you got to cancel your trip to the beach. You got to get rid of those hobbies. Glory to God. Amen. You see, we fear surrendering to Christ's lordship. Amen. Because we think it means denying us enjoyment. Can I tell you, not once has the Lord ever told me, sell that harlot. But you know what? If he ever did, this much I know, there's something greater on the other side of that sail that he wants for me. Lord God, because this much I know about the Lord. He is always trying to prosper us. He is always trying to help us. He is always trying to grow us and move us in the right direction. He is always trying to take us in a kingdom direction. He is always trying to get us to the place, amen, that we are moving in abundance and not lack. Listen to me, folks. Whatever the Lord tells you to do, do it, because something greater is coming. Praise God. But people fear the Christship, the Lordship of Christ, because they're afraid of what they're going to have to give up. Well, boo friggity hoo. I'm sorry, that was a phrase my daddy coined when he preached. And it's just stuck. You see, but that's the perception we have. That's the perception Satan wants us to have. There's no question, Lord God, that God will convict us and ask for changes, amen, when we accept him as our Lord and Savior, glory to God. But he does that to bless us. He wants to remove those things that could harm us and prevent us from being a better person. Oh, glory to God. Listen, oh, listen to what the Bible, how the Bible describes God's character toward us. Zechariah 2:8, the Word of God says that we're the apple of his eye. First John chapter 3:1 says, great is the love the Father has lavished on us. First Corinthians 2:9 says, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. Again, Romans 8:31, if God be for me, who can be against me? My God, God wants the best for you. Quit letting the devil put fear of the Lordship of Christ in you. There's a tremendous blessing in surrendering to Christ's Lordship, because it puts you in the safest place you could ever possibly be. And that's why Satan fights Christians the way he does, with this issue of total surrender. You see, he knows, Satan understands and knows, Christians that are submitted to Christ live directly in the path of God's blessings. Whew. I don't know about y'all, but I want Ruth moments in my life. What are you talking about, Ruth moments in your life? I want Ruth moments in my life. Lord God, we're serving the eternal Boaz. Lord of God, and if you ever go back and read that story in Ruth, where Ruth is over in the field of Boaz, Lord of God, Boaz takes a shine to her, Lord of God, because she's out there early in the morning and she stays late. And Boaz looks at his servants and says, what I want you to do is while she's going around the outer edges of the field, amen, I want you to leave handfuls on purpose for her, Lord God. When she gets out there and she gets hot and she thinks there's nothing else she can do, all of a sudden she runs up on a handful on purpose. My God, I don't know about y'all, but every time I've run up on a handful on purpose, it always energizes me to want to do more for the kingdom and to go further. And I've come to tell you that our eternal Boaz has left you this morning a handful on purpose to get you further down the road than you are right now. He has put you smack dab in the path of his blessings. Don't fear the Lordship of Christ. Number two, submitting to Christ's Lordship involves trust. Look at your neighbor and say, it involves trust. It involves trust. Luke chapter 6, verse 46 says, Jesus, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not what I say? This wasn't Peter, James, and John talking here. This was Jesus. Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do what I say? That's a fair question from our Lord, ain't it? It's a very fair question. If any statement applies to the American culture today, amen, that one does. How can 80% of Americans claim to be Christians, yet so few of that 80% subscribe to biblical principles? The answer is very obvious, glory to God. People don't submit to Christ's Lordship and obey his word because they don't trust him. They just don't believe what he says. How many of you believe today that he's still a healer? Come on, lift your hands, get them up high. You believe he's a healer? You believe that if you got sick, now you're telling me, you believe that if you got sick, diagnosed with a deadly disease, doctor looks you in the eyeball, points his finger at your nose and tells you it is inoperable, you're not going to survive, you're going to die. Lord God, you still believe this word right here that tells you that he's a healer? Oh, come on now. See, about half your hands went up that time. How many of you believe what the word says? I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed begging bread. How many of you believe that if you get into a financial situation, Lord God, the money dries up and you got more bills than you got month, and you come on, you got more bills than you got money. Lord God, how many of you believe that if you're paying your tithes and doing what you're supposed to be doing as a child of God, that God will step up and take care of you? Come on now, folks. You got to trust what He says. There's so many today that can't call Him Lord, because the minute they get into a scrape, Sister Denise, they lay this word down and start picking up complaining and griping and moaning. Lord, and instead of drawing closer to God in church, when the problem comes, they'll stay at home behind closed doors and mope. You know I'm telling the truth. Come August, I'll be a pastor for 30 years. I've seen a lot. But the one thing that is consistent is when folks get in trouble, Brother John, they'll stay away from church. The place you ought to be running to, where there's brothers and sisters that'll lay hands on you. Maybe you don't have the faith to believe for what you need, but there's others around you that God has put faith in that'll take that word, lay hands on you, my God, and God will divide the sea. God will part the water. God will divide that need, and seeing what you need, and your help will come, my God. But we got to trust Him. We got to trust Him. I know this ain't popular. I never claimed to be a popular preacher. Don't want to be a popular preacher. Want you to like me, but if you don't, that's all right too. I'm going to heaven. You're going to have to see me throughout eternity. And I'm going to smile at you and go, You see, God has already provided the ultimate testimony to assure us He is trustworthy. He sent His only begotten Son from the glories of heaven to suffer ridicule and abuse and betrayal to show us He loved us. Since He surrendered His absolute best to us, it's only reasonable that we will continue to work. Glory to God, that He will work for us all things for our good. Do I like everything that comes my way? No, I don't. Lord God, does it say that everything that comes my way is good? No, it does not. But this much I know, all things will work out for my good. Whether it's good or whether it's bad, whether it's ugly or whether it's pretty, my God, it will work out if I'll stay the course, if I'll hold His nail-scarred hand, if I'll trust Him. It will work out. When the dust settles and the smoke clears, I'll still be standing, and so will you if you'll trust God. Our Heavenly Father, in the Lordship of Christ, is saying, do you love me? Then give me your life. I want everything. Oh, but that makes us squirm. That makes us squirm thinking about that surrender. You see, in the struggle to submit to God's call can be agonizing. But when we finally say yes, He takes what's cheap in our life and gives us what's priceless, the Son, Jesus Christ, and His promises, glory to God. Again, is Jesus Lord of your life? Listen, glory to God. You can trust Him, because this much I know. Jeremiah 29:11 says this: I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and to have a future. Glory to God. Let me ask you a question. Let me run a scenario with you. Glory to God. Have you ever driven on a two-lane road and gotten stuck behind slow drivers? My wife seen this on the way to Panama City 2 weeks ago. I can't stand getting behind slow drivers. It's frustrating. It's frustrating. Every time you get there, what do? You veer out to peek around the vehicle. Amen. But there's another curve. There's a hill. There's an oncoming car. Amen. To have to deal with. So you're stuck creeping behind those vehicles for miles. But imagine, get this in your imagination. Imagine if in a helicopter above you was flying your best friend. Someone you could trust with your life. And let's say they phoned you from that helicopter and say, I can see the road ahead of you for miles. There's no crossroads. There's no oncoming traffic. And it's perfectly safe for you to pass. Move into the left lane and pass now. Would you have the confidence to get in that lane and pass? Would you drive by faith in your best friend above that has a perfectly great view of the road? Or would you continue to drive by your sight and say, sorry, I'll pass when I can see it for myself? Listen to me. In life, God is just like that. He's our best friend. He's our guide. Oh, he's our leader. And from his heavenly perspective, he has a better view than any aircraft. The Bible says he knows the end from the beginning. And that means we can completely trust in his guidance. You got to learn to trust him. And last of all, come on, brother. Why is the Lordship so important? Why is it so important? Here's why it's important to acknowledge Christ as Lord and let him direct your life. It's the only way we can become more like Christ. Because if he's not leading you, then who is? Because let me tell you, put it this way. If Christ ain't leading you, then you're either leading yourself or somebody else is leading you. And if you're leading yourself or somebody else is leading you, then guess who you're going to become like? If we've got to let the Lord be Lord of our life if we're going to become more like Christ. You see, it's the only way to develop our spiritual maturity, glory to God. You see, there are times, amen, we get stuck on spiritual plateaus because something isn't submitted to Christ. I want to ask you a question. Can I ask you three questions? I promise I'll get out of your way. Let me ask you three questions right quickly. First of all, Lord, I'll give you anything in my life except. Except what? Lord, I'll do anything for you except what? Lord, I'll change anything in my life except. How many of us are saying the same thing to the Lord? I'll do this, but I won't do this, and I won't change that, and I won't give this up. I will not surrender completely everything. And we hold some things back. Listen to me, if there is any practice or relationship that hinders our walk with Christ, you are limiting the flow of God's grace toward you. You can't imagine what God has for you until you fully surrender to him. Glory to God. Now I've got a whole lot more, but I'm just going to move on. Stand with me in this place. Can I tell you what the Lord's after this morning? Jesus said it best. In Matthew chapter 5 and verse 8, when Jesus began to preach that Sermon on the Mount, listen to what he said. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Jesus says, those who maintain a pure and undefiled heart towards God will be rewarded with seeing Him. And I know that this is talking about making it to heaven, but can I go ahead and introduce this? That I believe Jesus was not only talking about, glory to God, us seeing Jesus when we get to glory, but I believe that he was also saying if we'll have a pure and undefiled heart here, we will see some things of glory right here on this earth. We will see the Lord move right here. If we'll draw near to him with a pure heart, glory to God, we'll see him working in our circumstances. When we have a pure heart, we'll see God, the God of grace and mercy, operating on our behalf in this life. Jesus is Lord. Or is he? Or is he? Is he really the Lord of your life? Because I don't want to hear him say to me, why call me Lord? And do not the things I say. Well, Lord, did we not cast out devils in your name? Lord, did we not do miracles in your name? Lord, did we not do this in your name? Blah, 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 blah. Depart from me, you worker of iniquity, for I never knew you. It's a very serious thing . Our Church of God camp meeting was this last week. I didn't go. I don't usually go to camp meeting anymore. If you went, God bless you. I'm glad you did. It was, from what I've seen on the services, was phenomenal. The preaching was great, but it's behind the scenes of what gets me. All the politics, all the, for a lack of a better term, brown nosing, all the schmoozing, all the going up and trying to move here and make deals here, and I want to go just because I want to be close to this one and close to that one. When are we going to get to the place to understand man can't get us nowhere? I love my general overseer, but my general overseer can't do nothing for me. I love my state overseer, but my state overseer can't do nothing for me. I've got men in this state on the state council that I've known personally for years, Lord God, but they can't do anything for me. When are we going to get back to the place to say, I need Jesus and Him alone? Jesus can open doors that are closed. He can close doors that are open. He can do things man can't even think about doing. But is he Lord of our life? And if he is not, If he is not, what this morning is standing between you and him being Lord? What area of your life are you holding on to and keeping back from the Lordship of God? And what does this particular area in your life, why does it have you running from God? Is it because you think God wants to rob you of something you enjoy? Do you think Jesus is trying to make you miserable or punish you? But listen to me. Jesus is pursuing you this morning because he loves you. And he wants to rescue from some things that are trying to destroy you this morning. And it's time to throw your hands up and surrender. And say, I want you to be Lord. Closed. My God. This morning, Jesus is begging you to come. He's drawing you this morning through the Holy Spirit to come. Say, let me be Lord. Crown me as Lord of your life. This morning, with every head bowed, every eye closed, is there anybody in here who'd say, Pastor, I've held back some areas in my life that the Holy Spirit's been dealing with me on. I've held back some areas, but I want to give them to the Lord. I want him to be Lord of my life. I want him to completely take my life. If that's you, would you just simply lift your hand this morning? God bless that hand. Come on, be honest. Is Jesus Lord of your life? God bless that hand. Is there anyone else? Pastor, I know I need him as Lord. Not just as my Savior, but I need him as Lord in my life this morning. This morning, if you raise your hand, or even if you didn't raise your hand, but you know you need to be in this altar, I want you to step out and come. Come on. Come on. Jesus is saying, I'm pursuing you. I'm after you this morning. I'm after you this morning because I love you. Because I love you. I'm after you because I want to be Lord of your life. Hallelujah. Come on. Anyone else this morning? Anyone else this morning? My God, can I get some folk up here helping me pray for these that are in this altar? Come on, church. Come on, saints. Help me. Help me, help me, help me right now. Help me. Help me right now. Lord, help me be you call me to be. I need everybody else to stretch your hands toward these that are in this altar this morning. Please pray. Please pray. If you're not praying for yourself, please pray for these that are in this altar. Thank you. Need to see the pastor's council for just a moment after service this morning, room 109. Also, leaders, leadership meeting this morning, this afternoon, fellowship hall immediately after service. Remember service tonight. Praise God. Brother Caleb will be bringing the word for us tonight. Looking forward to that. So I want you to be here. Come back prayed up, ready. Amen. To receive from the Lord. Stand with us if you would. Glory to God. We love you and appreciate you. Go forth in the power of the Holy Spirit. Father God, Lord, I pray a blessing upon this congregation. Lord, I pray that you minister to them. Lord, as we depart this place today, Lord, let this word, Lord, get in us. Let it get in our spirit. Lord, we want you to be Lord. Father, I pray a blessing upon each and every household. Let us be the head, not the tail, above and not beneath. Lord, I pray, God, bless us going in, bless us going out. Bless us, Lord, this week on our jobs. But Lord, more than anything, help us to be a blessing to somebody this week and lead them to the kingdom of God. Lord, to be a mouthpiece that shows them who Christ is. Lord, we'll give you the praise, the glory, the honor for it all in Jesus' name. And everybody say amen. Shake somebody's hand, hug their neck.